So 24 is one of my absolute favorite TV shows of all time. Just a couple days ago, season one of 24 Legacy came to a close. That means we now have 10 seasons of 24. That's the original 8 seasons from the original run, as well as then the Live Another Day revival with Kiefer Sutherland, and now 24 Legacy with Eric Carter as our lead character. With all that said, before I go into my ranking of these 10 seasons of 24, what did you think? Tell me in the comments section below, how do you rank the different seasons? Throw 24 Redemption, the movie, in there somewhere. Just give me the general idea. I'm not actually going to rank it, but I will tell you roughly where it falls into my listings. With all that said, this is my ranking. Coming in at number 10 is season 6 of 24. This is actually the first season of 24 that I watched live as it aired. I was kind of came late to the party. I watched the first 4 or 5 seasons the summer before 24 season 6 debuted, and so I was so pumped because the first 5 seasons are so good. Season 5 is one of my favorites of the show, and then the show debuts new, and I was so excited about finally watching it live. When I first watched it, I actually overlooked how really bad it was. I was just kind of going along with the ride of it. And then on reflection, thinking back on that season, I have almost nothing good to say about it. The plot in general just felt very derivative. There's terrorists that are attacking, but their way of making it more extreme was, let's ratchet it up, let's make it more intense. So they actually set a nuke off, they actually blow more stuff up, they've been ravaging the country, but it's just plot points that we've seen before in previous seasons, in which case it's kind of like, I don't like this. But really, the biggest problem with this season is central to the plot was all this family drama with Jack Bauer, and it put him in situations that I never wanted to see Jack Bauer in. So his dad, who's a monster, who's working with terrorists and responsible for all these deaths, and you see Jack groveling with him, like, "Dad, I'm sorry, I should have been a better son to you," and like, there's scenes like this in the season. It is just, it's really, really bad. I never want to see Jack Bauer do any of that, and that's like some of the major plots of this season, as well as there's like a character at the end of season 5 that you just kind of get hints at who it is, or you don't get any hints really of who it is, other than it's like this evil secret group of people that are really running things, and they can even have leverage over the president. And then we move into this season, and surprise, it's Jack Bauer's brother, which is so soap opera, so ridiculous. And it feels like suddenly now Jack Bauer's part of like this power family in the United States that have leverage, all sorts of things that change the nature of Jack Bauer. Because other than this, really this one thing, he's kind of an everyman that became special forces killer guy that then becomes CTU guy. But it's not that he was part of this super powerful family and that's why he was important. He was important because he was a hero and a man of action that then ended up partnering with David Palmer. And so all of that, I hated all of that, especially the more as I'm saying it right now, I'm getting angry thinking about it. But other things I really didn't like was what they did with Wayne Palmer, a character that was never, like, he wasn't awesome, but he was like a nice brother to David Palmer. He's not as good as David Palmer, but he's kind of like the dirtier side to him, where David Palmer was so squeaky clean, but his brother's kind of willing to get his hands dirty a little bit, but still a good guy. And then he comes back in season 5 and so liked what he was doing and seemed like a strong enough character. And then they make him the president in this season, and he's horrible. He's not a good president. Everything they did with it was a misfire. So this season, by far, just very clearly to me, the worst, and very much so because it wasn't good storytelling, it wasn't memorable, I didn't like what they did with it, but really because of what they did with Jack Bauer and all the family stuff hurt the mythology, it hurt the character of Jack Bauer. Coming in at number 9 is 24 Legacy. Unfortunately, the season that just aired is the second worst to me. It doesn't ruin the legacy in ways that I think that season 6 kind of messed with Jack Bauer a little bit. This doesn't do this. It's harmless. It just did not pull me in at all. And the big problem is that we have this whole new set of characters in the same universe, but none of them were as captivating to me as the characters that came before them. And it's not that I wanted Senator Donovan to be David Palmer. It's not that I wanted Carter to be Jack Bauer. It's not that they needed to be these point by point, but they weren't better. They weren't like interesting. They didn't have their own version of it. So you even think on like the original run of 24, the character of Chloe, who doesn't start in the show until season 3, and she becomes a mainstay of the whole rest of the series until this season. But like, she was a new character that was brought on. The show was great before she was there, and then they add her in, and she adds a new dynamic and a new twist to things that was interesting. And Bill Buchanan was added much later in the series. It was, I think, season four where Bill Buchanan becomes a character, a great character. And this season didn't, I feel like it had that. Carter came off very much so like random spy guy that can beat people up. He'd be the side character in a previous season. He didn't seem to have the gravitas to him, a charisma to him that would make him a lead character. And so it just felt like we were following a guy around that I just wasn't invested in. And then the direction they went with his family drama with his wife, I didn't care for it. It was, some of it was fairly off-putting because it put him currently as a bad husband. So like season one of 24, Jack Bauer and his wife had been separated before the season. And when it comes back, they're working on it. They're trying to redeem things. And so that has lingering consequences. So there's good tension and drama. They're not actively in Jack is lying to his wife. Jack is doing all this stuff that in the present makes a character unlikable. So the fact that the big reveals throughout the season is that Carter's been lying to his wife about trying to get into CTU and all sorts of stuff. That doesn't make him likable. And then the wife is kind of flirting with his brother. That makes her unlikable. And so there's all sorts of elements to it that just did not work for me. But overall, just the story of it felt like very familiar 24, except smaller scale. And so the first plot, there wasn't like a clear villain at the beginning. There's like this high school girl, and it spent so much time with her. And then her plot line just ends with a bang. And like that's kind of, and then we move on to, there's these other people that aren't very captivating. It's not like you think season four where they're chasing down Marwan and they're trying to get this guy. Or in season two, at the end of it, you want him, Jack, to take out Jigsaw from Saw. Like, there's specific guys, Dennis Hopper from season one, like, really interesting characters that you cared about bringing down. Charles Logan in season five. This season, it was terrorist guy that had a daughter and family members, and maybe they thought he was... Like, that's my response to it. I think, wasn't this another guy, like Arnold Vosloo from season four was from The Mummy? This guy's also from The Mummy, I think. I think that's who the actor was. But nothing captivating. I didn't feel like I want Carter to take this guy down. And then as the season goes along, you get into the final episode, and the way it even plays out, you don't want Carter to take this guy down because the guy's like, oh, I want to save my kid too. So he starts shooting terrorists himself. It makes him not a villain that you want just taken down and squashed. There wasn't like this urgency to save the people. And then in the end, the person in the finale that's supposed to be saved, not saved. And that's to say that the stakes of it were so poorly put together and the story of it so poorly put together that we get to the episode. There's not like a big thing that we want Carter to be able to do. The closest thing to that is to save someone's life, and he doesn't do that. And so there's not even like a victory in the last episode. It's like, okay, here we are. And we get to the end of the episode. And there's a time jump in it. I messed that up actually in my review that I recorded a couple days ago. But Senator Donovan decides that he's still going to run for president, even though his wife died a couple hours ago, three, four, you know, however many hours ago it was. His wife just died. He's like, I'm still going to run for president. And so he's been this unlikable character. Like, I don't want to see more of this character because he's not good. He's not captivating. He's not strong. He's not he's nothing enough interesting, any of these things enough for me to want to see more of them. Carter, I could see them redeeming Carter, get some new writers in there. Now, here's the scary thing about season 24 Legacy. It might not be renewed. The ratings are not good. The reviews have not been crazy good. So it's just kind of this thing that's likely to get canceled. And so the last episode of 24 we get is this one we just saw. Possibly. And if this one fails after Living Another Day didn't do great, and now this one hasn't done great, if this doesn't get picked up, there's a good chance this is the final spot of 24 we ever get. And it's like, okay, he'll take a job. His wife's not leaving him. This guy's going to do what he was doing at the beginning. Okay, nothing's really changed. Oh, this bad guy we didn't care about, he was taken down, and the person we were supposed to save didn't get saved. Okay, it happened. Like, that's not a good finale to 24. That is not satisfying. As an episode, if it was like episode 8, it might have been okay. But as a finale, not a good finale. So that's the whole season. Is this disappointing? Lack of action, lack of tension, that sense of urgency that 24 can do really well because there's a literal ticking clock throughout the whole series. And so you feel an urgency that the fact that this show doesn't have, or this season didn't have it, really points to the fact that it was pretty poorly done. Now, so these two I just did, these are the bad seasons of 24. I would actually say that they're not really enjoyable, particularly enjoyable for me to watch at all. The rest of them moving forward are good enough seasons to great seasons. Coming in at number 8 is season 8 of 24. Now, like I said, moving forward, these are all seasons I enjoyed. The next few are seasons that I was just kind of lukewarm about. In particular, season 8, the thing is, I don't have any big issues with it. I don't have any big gigantic complaints, where some of the future ones I'm going to talk about, I'm going to have specific issues with them. But there were things that really worked for me. Season 8 was just kind of like, okay, that happened. It was just forgettable for me. I don't remember what the main tension and plot of the first half of the season was, and I've seen it 2 or 3 times, and I couldn't tell you what it is. And so that's a problem. The big thing I remember about the season is halfway through it, obviously Jack Bauer's new love interest. Like, the real only thing I remember about this season is that Jack hooks up with Renee. She dies, he goes on a killing spree and has to go on the run for his life at the end of the season, which wasn't particularly satisfying. But as for many of the specifics and like the plot line with the president and all that stuff, I don't really remember it, because it was just forgettable and it happened. It wasn't bad enough that I remember how bad it was. It was just forgettable, and that's in and of itself not good and a very big issue with it. It wasn't a particularly satisfying end to the original run. It wasn't terrible. It wasn't frustrating. It was just kind of like, really? That's okay. I guess that's what you got to do. If you're not going to kill him, I guess that's what you do. So overall, just kind of a forgettable season. Coming in at number 7 is 24, Live Another Day. Overall, there were a lot of things that I liked about this season. I liked that they brought back Audrey Raines. I liked that Heller became the president, and he was very much a continuation of what we saw before, which is he's got a lot of good qualities, he's got a lot of dickish qualities, and all of that is very much on display here. And so I liked that dynamic of bringing characters that had a long history with Jack of good and bad interactions with them. But at the same time, for everything, I was like, that was really cool, I like what you're doing here. There are other things I was like, what? So like, they make Chloe O'Brien this emo hacker cyberpunk type thing that not a good direction. It was a weird direction to go, because they took a character that was just very computery, and it wasn't just that she switched to cyber terrorism, it's that she changes her look to emo goth look to it that does not fit the character at all for the way she is in the story and has been up to this point in time, that she would suddenly like, I'm going to change my look to line up with these other people. It's just, that's not who she is. And so it stuck out, was very off-putting the entire season. The backstory of why she did that, why she switched sides with her family, I didn't like any of that. It just seemed really a dark direction to go with things, to just kind of be like, write it off in a line of dialogue, like, oh, they got killed by people trying to, like, I didn't like the way that was handled at all and the ramifications for it. And so there's a lot of little elements like that that even kind of made for the worldview of 24 is obviously this kind of darkness of the people connected to Jack, bad things happen to them, they die, and all sorts of suffering that he faces. But when you like bring then spouses and kids into it off screen through, it seems awfully off-putting to just do that like that. But like I said, at the same time, there's a bunch of things about the, like, the change of the format, so it was a half season. I thought that worked to cut all of the filler that's in almost every full season of 24. There's a bunch of filler in it. This one cut all that, and to almost the extent that it felt rushed. Well, it did feel rushed towards the end. And right when you're like, they switched to the second plot line, it's like, wait, we got 2 episodes left. What are we doing? We could have stretched this or worked this a little bit differently. But there are good things and bad things, not everything about it. So the people, it was good they returned, and there was people that was like, they can't brought them back, but this is weird. The shorter length was good because there was no filler, but then it was rushed. And that was kind of the whole season's things I liked, things I didn't like. And for me, one of the things that was most interesting about this season is that John Boyega, now of 24, of Star Wars fame, I first saw him on this because he was cast in Star Wars, and then they said he was going to be in the season of 24, and so then I saw him and I was like, okay, that he's not doing much for me, or he's not doing much here, so I don't know if I like him or not. And this is the first thing I ever saw him, because I still haven't seen Attack the Block, actually. Anyway, that's a rabbit trail about Star Wars and John Boyega. Overall, yeah, enjoyable. I don't dislike this. I can watch this one and enjoy it, but it doesn't like get me super pumped and excited. And there wasn't any one thing that I really liked about it, but it was good enough. Coming in number six is 24 season 7. This season had a lot of really good things about it. Like, I liked the new character of Renee. I really liked what they did with Bill Buchanan in this season and the story arc that he had and his final conclusion. I thought all of that worked really nicely. Elements of the plot line with the president and the husband, I thought some of those worked really nicely and I enjoyed those a good bit. But there was a lot of this one that just felt a little bit stale, a little bit repetitious, and then a little bit too soap opera-ish. So in general, sort of the main plot line of it, that there's evil shadow organizations, that there's people working behind the scenes. We've seen this before. Big terrorist type things, we've seen it before. And then they add something totally new into the mix. Tony Elmade is evil. Soap opera. And I, looking back on it now 10 years later, I wish they hadn't done that with Tony Almeida. I don't think it works for the best of the series in general. It was like a fun twist for the season, but they took him too dark. If they could have given him more redemption, if they could have found a path back for him, but they went so dark with him. They had him do so many things that they fully turned this character that was a hero of the first 5 seasons, really the first 4 seasons, into an actual villain. So much so that when he comes back in 24 Legacy, you're like, he's too evil. Like, you can't use him like this because he's too bad of a character based off what we saw him do before. So there's a lot of things that watching through this season. I'll say it this way: watching through this season, I enjoyed it a good bit. And even like Kurtwood Smith joining in this season and kind of being this person that's after Jack Bauer and have some back and forth where they actually come to some sort of understanding of one another. I thought all of that worked really nicely. The general flow of it worked really nicely. But it's one that, as I think back on it, I go, oh man, that Tony Almeida, I didn't care for that too much. And then the main plot of it, also beyond the Tony Almeida stuff, is pretty forgettable. There's characters I like, the character arcs I really like outside of Tony Almeida, but the actual specific plot of it, not particularly captivating. But once again, like I said, as I was watching it, anytime I've rewatched, I've seen it about 4 times, I think, I enjoy it along the ride, but just not thinking about it in retrospect. Coming in at number 5 is season 3. This, to me, has always been the season I've always wanted to like more than I actually like it. It has all of the ingredients for it to be one of my absolute favorite seasons, but for something in the execution just never really worked for me. And the two things it just I just never connected with was the whole plot line involving taking down these drug lords and going to Mexico, as well as the Jack is an addict plotline. Those just never worked for me. They weren't interesting, and it just seemed like they were trying something different that didn't work. Beyond that, the plot line with David Palmer in the White House and Sherry Palmer shows up and causes trouble once again, it felt played out. It felt familiar. It felt like we have to have Sherry Palmer, and she just happens to show up on this day, and it just didn't work. It didn't have the freshness of the first 2 seasons. At the same time, once it gets going, about halfway through the season when it comes back from Mexico and it gets into the main plot line with the chemical warfare stuff, and especially the stuff where there's the hotel where the people are infected, I really start connecting with it then. And even like the main villain in it with Lance from Arrow being the main villain, I like him in it. That's the first thing that I know him from, was from 24. And those elements to it, when they start trying to like manipulate him and track his daughter down, all that stuff, all of that really works for me. And especially like when Michelle Dessler keeps getting in trouble and they're trying to rescue her and does she get infected and all that stuff, that tension all works for me. But the first half of it just, it wasn't tracking with me. And it's really frustrating because even like with Kim Bauer, they found a place for her on the show because she became old enough. She could be at 24. So they found a place for her, as well as giving her the boyfriend Chase. Like, all that didn't bother me. And some of that I really liked, the idea of Jack having kind of like a guy that he was working with that he really respected. I liked those elements, that him having a partner. But the season as a whole, because of the Mexico plot lines with the drugs and because the Sherry Palmer stuff and the tension on Palmer's end just felt too familiar, I never liked it as much as I wanted to. And like I said, Very enjoyable. I've probably rewatched it 5 or 6 times, which in the scheme of things of the shows out there, of seasons, having rewatched it that many times means I've rewatched it more than almost any other season out there. Compared to the seasons in front of it, I don't like it as much. So now we're moving into my top 4, and this is where it gets really, really tough for me, because the bottom 2, they really frustrated me, so that was pretty easy. And then the middle 4, that kind of disappointed me, but I still really enjoyed them a good bit. But it was pretty easy to rank them because of the way they emotionally affected me. The top 4 is really tough because I love all 4 of these seasons. They really work well for me, and so I was picking between, you know, favorites is what this top 4 really is for you. So with that said, coming in at number 4 is season 4. For me, this is only number 4 on my list, but like I said, as I was writing this and writing my notes for it, I was really tempted to move it up because in a lot of ways, this to me feels like 24 when it was in full stride and the show is just working. They're firing on all cylinders. And this might be the best crafted of the seasons in that there's a beginning first arc of it that's very nicely rounded, flows right, it doesn't slow down, it doesn't feel like filler, and so there's this whole plot line with Heller and trying to rescue him, and then there's the other plot line with the terrorist family, and all of it works nicely, moves at just the right pace that it doesn't feel like we're lingering too long. Then you move into the middle section of it, and you've got all this stuff where there's the president's planes brought down, the EMP goes off, and just a whole bunch of things kind of work in the middle there that it feels like we moved in a new direction that's a natural flow from what came before. And then you move into the final segment of it where Jack's trying to finally capture Marwan, we're breaking into the embassy, and having all these plot lines about Jack actually having to face the consequences for his actions. You get to see Logan as an imbecile, David Palmer gets to be the hero again. All this stuff works out really nicely for big reveals. And this season has some episodes that just pop the most for me that are just as good single standalone episodes, like the one where there's the couple that has the nuclear football on the run. That one works nicely for me. Like I mentioned, the ones where the EMP goes off, there's some stuff that just I thought really worked well. And this one probably has the best shootout in it, in the episode where they save Heller. So I say all that. I mean, this one, like I said, as I wrote my notes for it, as I'm saying this right now, I'm like, man, should I move this one up? Because I like it that much, and so much of it works for me. But at the same time, while it's well-crafted, all these elements that work nicely, and the new characters they add, whether Senator Heller, Audrey Raines, Bill Buchanan, great additions to the show. However, with all that said, it's just not as... it doesn't affect me the way the top 3 do. There's something unique about those 3 that just hit me. So with that said, moving up, number 3 is season 1 of 24. Season 1 of 24 just has such a freshness to it in this idea of a real-time action thriller with politics as well as assassin stuff and spy stuff. Just hit me when I first watched it. And so by the time I started watching it, it was already past season 5 of the show. And so my girlfriend, now wife, was like, hey, you should check out this show called 24. And I was like, okay, I will. And I like binged watched the whole first season in a weekend. I just fell in love pretty quickly with it. And rewatching it, the first season feels different from the other seasons. And some of that's true to just the nature of the show in that major things happen at the end of the first season where, spoiler alert. Well, if you're watching this, I've spoiled every season, so I don't know why I suddenly said that. But, obviously Teri Bauer dies, and this is the only season where at the beginning of it, you see Jack's normal life before the world of 24 begins, where his whole family's torn apart by the events of this season. And that kind of sets in motion the whole rest of the series. And so you see him in a very different phase of life that gives the season a different flavor to it. And even the stuff with Nina Myers and the way that twist really works that you're buying into as a hero, and even rewatching it, and I've rewatched it 5, 6, 7 times, and you're watching it and you like Nina Myers and you like her role in it, and there's an obviously adversarial nature with her with Teri, and there's all these elements to it that are really interesting, and you buy it even rewatching it. And you feel betrayed every time when it's revealed what's really been going on and what she's been doing and how she's been working against him. And so all these elements just make it so fresh and interesting. And it doesn't have this big plot line about a nuke that's going to blow up the city. It feels personal. It feels smaller scale. The first plot line is only about trying to get Jack Bauer to help get David Palmer assassinated. It feels small scale. The big finale is just Jack trying to rescue or getting revenge for his family's supposed death. And so all of that just, it feels unique amongst the series. It certainly has its filler episodes. You can tell at a certain point in time, they realized, oh crap, the show's getting picked up. What are we going to, where are we going from here? And they had to rework some stuff. You can tell that that kind of happened once they get past the first arc. But just overall, it works really nicely for me. And it fits nicely in the scheme of 24. And especially rewatching it, it feels so special and unique and different from the other seasons because it is the starting point. Coming to number two is season two of 24. This might be my most controversial placement of these. I've heard a lot of people criticize season two, especially specifically because of the Kim Bauer plotline and how she's going through the desert. Not desert, she's going through the woods and there's bobcats and then there's a guy in a shelter and then there's this guy that's abusing his family that kills them. I can't defend any of that. I just don't care. This is my ranking, and I'm ranking it based off what did work for me in the Jack Bauer plotline, the main plotline, all of that really works for me. I love what they did with Xander Berkeley's character in this season, where he's kind of sleazy in season one. They bring him back here, and they really give him a plotline that a sort of a sense of redemption, while not necessarily really doing anything to really redeem himself, but it's a redemptive story arc in where his character goes and what it has to do. And I love the Kate character as well, that just kind of, I thought, worked really nicely with Jack and bringing her along on the adventure. I liked all of where that kind of went. But for me, the thing that just pulls me in on this one is the second half of the season, where everybody wants David Palmer to go to war. He doesn't, so he gets pulled from office, and so because he trusts Jack so much. And so there's this sense of just every scene has tension and urgency to it. So the first time I ever watched this season, I got to around midnight, and it was around episode 14 or something like that. And I was like, this is interesting. Where's this going? And then 1 a.m, oh man, I better watch the next one. And I stayed up all night. I had to work the next day, but I stayed up all throughout the night to finish the season just because it was so captivating to me. And the actual sense of urgency, that tension that I think is a staple what makes me love 24 is the ticking clock and the plot lines that they run in it actually can create like this edge of your seat. What's going to happen next? Will he get there in time? What's going to happen? And I thought this season just had the best of that, as that second half in particular. It's also got some great little cameos in it. It's got Ro Laren from Star Trek The Next Generation. We've got actually the guy that played the Red Skull in the 1990 version of Captain America. He plays David Palmer's lawyer later in some of the last few episodes of it. And you've got Ron Swanson from Parks and Rec. Actually, it's the racist guy that, takes out the partner guy from the other country that they're working with. So a bunch of cool stuff like that happens to be in this season. But also the last episode of this season is one of my favorite, it has my favorite Jack Bauer fight in it at the Coliseum, where he fights the guy in the hallway. That's my favorite Jack fight in the whole series. Just love that final episode. And just the tension that they built, that Jack gets tortured in the second half of the season, and his heart's failing for the rest of the season. Like, things like that, that he's tired, he's beat up, and he's been tortured, and so he's not functioning at full Jack, and that's one of the reasons that he might fail, that he almost fails. Things like that that just make for a well-crafted, nicely thought-out season where stakes matter, and it has, like, themes of trust to it, that Kate trusts Jack, Jack trusts her, David Palmer trusts Jack, and through all of this, that they're battling it out against everyone. Everyone is against them, leading all the way to this finale where they save the day. One of my favorite finales of the whole show. And that leads us to number one, and that is season five. This season seemed to be where they were kind of hit their creative peak, where they were at just the right spot where they could have great stakes, and they were bold enough to actually commit to killing off a lot of main characters in that first episode and just turning the show upside down. It was so risky, and where they left at the end of season four with Jack faking his death, they could have found themselves in a corner where things were going to go really bad, and they just found just the right plot line to give Jack the motivation to come back, and you really care about what he's trying to do. And then even from there, that they build on kind of these bigger conspiracies of organizations that are running things behind the scenes that are just fascinating 24 type stuff that I love. And they take it all the way up to the top, almost to the level that they kind of ran themselves in the corner of how do we top this? Where do we go from here? Now that we've had Jack go after the president himself, how do you top that? Oh, they never have. This is where it peaked for me. Obviously, it's my number one. But just overall, it's just a captivating season that I don't really have any issues with it. Throughout the whole thing, they found new plot lines to keep it fascinating from the get-go. Jack out for revenge because this character, that beloved character of David Palmer that Jack loves, that we love. And so Jack needs to find out who did it and how deep does all of that go. Charles Logan becomes, you know, maybe the greatest villain of 24, and he's the president. And so, I mean, just all of that so interesting and tension that matters because Jack is facing off a guy that has all the power to stop them. And all along the way, there's little characters where people team up with Jack, where the government works against Jack. All of it works really great. And then Wayne Palmer makes a return in this season. It has little elements to it that just make you like him, that he's a guy that, as I mentioned before, I didn't particularly like him when he becomes president, but here you like him because he's a guy that wants revenge for his brother's death, and so he's working to find things out, work all of that out. Aaron Pierce, a guy that I probably should have mentioned by now, but you see him as this guy that's loyal to Jack, he's loyal to David Palmer, and so therefore he's working with Jack to bring down this evil president who's caused all this to happen. So overall, it's just kind of the peak of all the best elements of 24 working together. And the reason somewhat that I put it even on top is because it works, even though like David Palmer has such a presence, so key to this season, even though he's in it for all of a minute, and where David Palmer's such a great character, then even in his absence, a season that's all about him just has such a gravitas, and you care so much about where it goes, how it works out. And so this season to me, the peak of 24, the best written, the best encapsulated, and some great single episodes in there too, like the one at the airport, where Jack's, you know, trying to spy on him and save the passenger, or save the hostage and stuff. Like, little episodes like that just pop to me and are very memorable to me. This is the first place I saw Connie Brighton, who later went on to be Friday Night Lights and now on Nashville. And so the first time I saw, and this is, to me, the thing that I still remember is her on this as the person that Jack was living with after he faked his death. So overall, just a great season of 24. So that's my ranking of the 10 seasons of 24. If I were to place the movie 24 Redemption, I'd put it right in that middle of that category of just the kind of forgettable 24, so around 7, 8 on my ranking, somewhere in there. It's not bad. It's just not one that I'm going to rush out to rewatch. I don't remember specific things about it. Nothing in particular excited me, and I don't have any issues with it either. It's just kind of, that happened. That was enjoyable enough. That's my ranking. How do you guys rank 24? Tell me in the comment section down below. I would love to spark up some nice conversations about 24 and how crazy I am that I got season 2 where it's at, or whatever else kind of interesting ideas you have on it. Let's talk about all 10 seasons of 24 plus the movie Redemption down in the comment section. If you're new to my channel, please consider clicking that subscribe button. I do normally do movie reviews, sometimes do TV reviews, like I reviewed this whole season of 24 and did this ranking right here. Also talking about movie news, trailer reactions from time to time. Got this new thing called Masters of Movie Trivia. It's a movie trivia show with me and some other YouTubers competing to discover who is the master of movie trivia. With all that said, please consider subscribing and thank you for watching.